In the last class, we have studied about the peptic ulcer. Now, in this class, we will study about the tumors and tumor-like lesions. Tumors, you know that it is a mass of tissue formed as a result of abnormal, excessive, uncontrolled, autonomous, purposeless proliferation of cells even after the cessation of the stimuli. It is of two types, benign, which is not so fatal, it is very slow growing, it becomes harmful only because of its position. While the malignant one is there is a rapid proliferation of cells in which the patient is stumbled to death. Now, there are also mass of tissues formed which looks like tumor, but there is no malignant characters. It is the growth of a mass from the mucous membrane of the alimentary canal into the lumen, projecting above the level of the surrounding mucosa. It is a disorganized growth of tissue which are indigenous to the site. They are the malformations of the tissues. That is what we call hematomatous polyp. Hematomatous polyps are those in which the indigenous abnormal mixture of tissues takes place. That is called hematoma. Example is gastric polyp and Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. And second is the juvenile polyps found in the 1 to 5 years baby. So these polyps are formed as a result of any inflammation in the alimentary tract. It leads to regeneration of the mucous membrane and it projects into the lumen. So it is a regenerative inflammatory polyp which is never neoplastic. 90% commonest are due to this inflammation. Gross examination, sessile or pedunculated, smooth and soft. Microscopically, there is irregular hyperplastic gland. This lining epithelium is gastric type. No malignant changes has been seen in this type of polyps. Lamina propria contains the inflammatory infiltrates. Coming to the tumor, that is the benign tumor. As it is lined by columnar epithelial, so the benign epithelium are benign growth tumors are called adenomas. So it is rare in the stomach, mostly in large intestine it occurs. If it is in the stomach, it is in the region of pyloric entrum. It is always associated with atrophic gastritis and pernicious anemia. From the connective tissues, benign tumors are called stromal tumors because they are from the origin from the connective tissue. If it is from muscle tissue, it is leiomyoma. If it is from nervous tissue, it is neurofibroma. If it is from the fat cells, then it is called lipoma. It appears as a circumscribed submucous nodule of less than 4 cm in size. Recently, this stromal tumors has been named as gastrointestinal spindle cell tumor, GIST, because these stromal tumors are benign in the beginning but soon becomes very aggressive and even metastasizes to different places. So coming to the malignant tumor of the stomach, incidence, it is worldwide distributed, but most oftenly it occurs in the eastern countries like China and Japan, in which the people take so much spice food in their food, whereas in the western countries it is less. Male predominates over the female, and the lower socioeconomic people are affected much more with these malignant tumors. It is the leading killing cancer, representing 3.5% of all cancer deaths. Pathogenesis, environmental factors are most important in which diet. This primary diet is the primary offender, because the preservatives these days in the food are carcinogenic substance like N-nitrobenzoin and benzopyrene compounds. Lack of refrigeration and consumption of preserved, smoked and salted foods, water contamination with nitrates and lack of fresh greeny vegetables, all these contribute to the pathogenesis of malignant tumors in the stomach. Conversely, the intake of green leafy vegetables, citrus fruits in which there are antioxidants like ascorbic acid, tocopherol and beta carotenes, they prevent it from the malignancy of the stomach. Host factor: H. pylori infected chronic gastritis, autoimmune gastritis. Only H. pylori infected persons, they may be asymptomatic, but when they are associated with chronic gastritis, then in that case malignancy is can occur. 1% of the patients of gastric cancer has the history of gastric ulcer. Dysplasia of gastric mucosa is the final pathway by which the intestinal type of gastric carcinoma arises, as seen in gastric adenoma. That means there is a dysplastic changes into the intestinal type, whereas in the diffuse type of gastric carcinoma it appears as de novo without evolution through the dysplasia. So the genetic factor, 4% of these patients have the family history of this gastric carcinoma, whereas blood group A persons suffer much more gastric carcinoma than the other blood group persons. Morphologically, this gastric carcinoma is located 50-60% in pylorus and pyloric antrum, 25% in cardia and 15% body and fundus. The favored sites are lesser curvature of enteropyloric region. Classification has been done on the basis of the depth of the invasion, whether early gastric carcinoma when the lesion is limited up to mucosa and submucosa, and lesions when they extend through the submucosa to the muscle or even goes beyond that, then it is called advanced gastric carcinoma. Macroscopic growth pattern, there are three types: ixophytic, as the name suggests, that the tumor mass projects exteriorly into the lumen. Flat or depressed gastric wall is extensively infiltrated by malignant cells, creating thickening of the wall. Excavated cancer, that is large irregular cancerous ulcers. Histologically, subtypes, there are two types: the intestinal type, in which the adenomas develop the neoplastic changes like that of adenocarcinoma of the colon. It is always expanding growth pattern, whereas in the diffuse type they are composed of the gastric type of mucus cells. No gland is formed, and there is an infiltrative growth pattern. So the conventional classification is early gastric carcinoma. It is the initial stage of carcinoma confined to gastric mucosa, and advanced gastric carcinoma when the mucosa and submucosa both is penetrated and it reaches to muscularis mucosa or beyond that. So early gastric carcinoma in Japan, 35% of newly diagnosed cases belong to the early gastric carcinoma, and others are advanced gastric carcinoma. So on gross examination, this early gastric carcinoma has three types: type 1 polypoid, that is protruded type; type 2a superficially elevated, superficially flat or superficially depressed; and type 3 is ulcerative type. You have got a very beautiful diagram in your textbooks. So kindly go through the diagrams and then you will appreciate the patterns of early gastric carcinoma. Histologically, the early gastric carcinoma, typical glandular adenocarcinoma with well differentiated cells, you can appreciate. Prognosis after surgical dissection, 5-year survival is 99%, up to 99%. So far the advanced gastric carcinoma is concerned, it has also 5 types. Ulcerative carcinoma, which is the most common pattern, flat, infiltrating and ulcerative growth, irregular necrotic base and raised margin, more in the region of gastric canal. Histologically, when you examine the slides, you will get poorly differentiated adenocarcinoma, maybe tubular or acinal pattern. Second type of advanced gastric carcinoma is fungating polypoid carcinoma. It has a cauliflower-like growth projecting into the lumen. The site is fundus and histologically papillary type of well-differentiated adenocarcinoma. Then comes Skyrus carcinoma. As this name suggests, Skyrus, that means fibrous tuft. It is also called Linitis plastica or leather bottle stomach. Leather bottle you must have seen in the people living in the deserts. They carry the water in leather bottles. Like that, this stomach becomes leather bottle in this type of Skyrus carcinoma, which has got thickened stomach wall. It is because of extensive dysmoplasia. Dysmoplasia is the character of the tumor cells in which they elaborate the fibroblastic growth factors, leading to excessive fibrous tissue formation and causing this Skyrus nature of this type of carcinoma. Histologically, adenocarcinoma is there with signet ring cell carcinoma. Due to extensive dysmoplasia, cancer cells are very difficult to locate because there is an abundance of fibrous tissue. Then comes the colloid carcinoma, of which site is the fundus and appears as a tumor mass which has a gelatinous appearance because of the large quantities of mucin. Histology, this mucoid carcinoma contains pools of mucin in which tumor cells appears as signet ring cells. Ulcer cancer, from chronic gastric ulcer, this type of ulcer cancer develops. Microscopically, when you examine a peptic ulcer zone in one part and in another part, the carcinomatous changes are seen. So to differentiate whether this ulcer belongs to peptic ulcer or it is a malignant ulcer, if it is peptic ulcer, it is a benign ulcer. So benign ulcers occurs in younger age, whereas malignant ulcer comes in older age. Both sexes are affected similarly. Duration of the symptoms in benign ulcer, it is weeks to years, but in malignant ulcer it is weeks to months. Location, lesser curvature in the benign ulcer, whereas malignant ulcer occurs in the greater curvature, antrum, and on gross examination these peptic ulcers are small, regular, and in them mucosal folds are radiating in a spoke-like manner and ulcer bed is hemorrhagic, whereas in cancer cells it is larger, irregular, interpreted and necrotic. Barium study, if done in both cases, in benign ulcer or in gastric ulcer, it is punched out ulcer, whereas in cancer cell it shows irregular filling defect. Acidity, normal to low in benign ulcer, whereas normal or achloridia in cancer ulcers. Therapy, so far the medicinal therapy is concerned, this benign gastric ulcer responds very quickly, very nicely, whereas there is no response to medical therapy. Now the spread of this malignancy, it can occur directly by local extension, which is more common feature in the gastric carcinoma. From loose submucosal layer, it can go upwards to the esophagus, downwards to the duodenum, or transversely it can invade to muscular layer and then serous layer, and then comes at the peritoneal layer. On the peritoneal layer, this cancer cells can spread by very peculiarly. There is a transilomic dissemination. Transilomic means through the abdominal cavity, these cancer cells from the serous layer of the stomach, they just sheds out into the abdominal cavity, and they can attach to any abdominal organ. It takes place particularly on the ovary, and there the secondary metastasis, secondary cancer, carcinoma of the ovary takes place, what we call Krukenberg tumor. This is very much, you will find it in clinical words also, this Krukenberg tumor of the ovary. So you can get notes in your examination about the transilomic dissemination and about the Krukenberg tumor of the ovary. So it can also directly spread to the neighboring structures, to lesser and greater omentum, pancreas and liver. Lymphatic spread to regional lymph nodes on serous carcinoma, to lymph nodes around the greater and lesser omentum, and in the left supraclavicular lymph node, there the lymph node becomes enlarged, called Virchow's sign. Sometimes it is the presenting sign of gastric carcinoma. Patient comes for something else, and when the doctors examine systematically, when they found the large matted supraclavicular lymph node, then they suspect that to be gastric carcinoma. There may be hepatogenous spread to liver, lung and brain. So every malignancy has been staged because in view of the prognosis and treatment. Similarly, American Joint Committee has developed TNM staging for gastric carcinoma. T stands for tumor invasion, N for nodal involvement, and M for distant metastasis. So earliest region is tumor in situ, that is intraepithelial tumor, to no nodal involvement, to no metastasis. If it becomes advanced stage, then it becomes tumor invading anywhere, node, any node involved, and metastasis takes place. So clinically it has a very diverse presentation: persistent abdominal pain, distension and vomiting, loss of weight, loss of appetite, and this disease remains undiagnosed for a longer period because the symptoms the patient tells is very vague. Unless the symptoms becomes very aggressive, by that time the metastasis has taken place, then the prognosis becomes very rare, very poor. 5-year survival rate in 5 to 15% cases of advanced gastric carcinoma at the time of diagnosis, but when it is tumor is inside in situ, carcinoma in situ, intraepithelial tumors, then it becomes 99% if the surgery is done. So this is all about the malignancy, and this finishes the stomach. Now we will study a very clinical topic like appendicitis, that is the acute inflammation of the appendix. This appendicitis is a very acute condition, and one of the emergencies you will see in the wards. So this, the older children's, young adults who are having high protein rich diet, no cellulose diet, then these people comes with their pain in the right iliac fossa and with pain, vomiting and temperature, all suggestive to the appendicitis. So that was the clinical picture. Now, so far the anatomy of the appendix is concerned, you know that it is a diverticulum of the cecum, which is about 7 cm. You know that it is a vestigial organ. It has no useful purpose in human being because the human beings take less of cellulose, and it is a, rather it becomes a seat of trouble. So normal histology, you know that there are 4 layers: serous layer, muscular propria of 2 layers, submucosa in which there are lymphatic nodules, muscularis mucosa is interrupted, lamina propria again contains lymphatic nodules, and in mucosa there are crypts of lycoverkin which are tubular and in shape. So etiopathogenesis, this appendicitis occurs because of obstruction in 50 to 60% cases. Most common cause of obstruction is fecolith or gallstone tumor or ball of horns. When the organ becomes obstructed by any of these causes, then there is a continued secretion of mucinous fluid in the lumen, which leads to progressive increase in the intraluminal pressure, which causes collapse of the drainage veins into the appendix, that is called ischemic injury. Now this favors bacterial proliferation with additional inflammatory edema and exudation, which further embarrasses the arterial supply. And then the clinical sign of this acute appendicitis sets in. Besides this, there may be non-obstructive cause of appendicitis, that is hematogenous spread of infection and vascular occlusion. So morphologically, when you examine, it depends upon appendix, it depends upon the stages of inflammation you see. And the earliest stage, there are scanty neutrophilic exudate found in the all the layers, but as the time progresses, early acute appendicitis stage, there is a subserosal vessels are congested, perivascular neutrophilic infiltration, then the normal glistening serous layer becomes dull granular and red membrane. This transformation suggests the surgeon to go for the operation. If it is not done, then it changes into acute suppurative appendicitis, in which prominent neutrophilic exudate causes fibrinopurulent exudate over the serous layer. With progress of inflammation, abscess formation is there. And the mucosa, there is suppurative necrotic tissues are found. Even if it is not treated, then it changes into acute gangrenous appendicitis, which further leads to large areas of hemorrhage with green ulceration of the mucosa. This green black gangrenous necrosis throughout the wall reaches up to the serous layer, and then this organ can rupture at this site and leading to suppurative peritonitis, is still a very grave condition for the patient. So gangrene develops, then it is bound to rupture. Gangrene, you know that it is a form of necrosis of the tissue with superadded infection. There is a coagulative necrosis, and sometimes besides this presentation, sometimes what happens that because of recurrent attacks of acute appendicitis or in old age, there is a stage called chronic appendicitis, and sometimes there may be some appendicular lump is formed by, if there is an inflammation in the acute appendicitis, and if it is going to subside, the surrounding tissues may form, and after the inflammation subsides, they form an acute appendicular lump. At this stage, the patient can also come to your ward telling you there is a vague pain in right iliac fossa with some swelling in the right iliac fossa. So chronic appendicitis, when you examine histological slides, then you will see that there is a mucosal lymphoid tissues are no more there. They are replaced by the fibrous tissue. Mucosa and submucosa of the appendix disappears. Lumen is blocked by fat and fibrous tissue. Muscular wall is relatively normal with no evidence of inflammation in respect to cellular or vascular events, but there is a presence of lymphocytes and fibrous tissue in all the layers that is suggestive of chronic appendicitis. So it is a disease of adolescents and young adults, and its clinical feature is classical triad, pain, vomiting and temperature, and it is called Murphy's sign. Complication is perforation. So this is all about the appendicitis, a very clinical condition you will come across in the wards. Now in the next class we will study about the small intestine. Thank you.